Ah, what an introduction. I can't wait to see myself tonight. It is indeed a pleasure, and more than that, an honor to be able to come to Eureka and visit a portion of turf territory where Ronald Reagan's formative years took place. Small town America in Hollywood is usually portrayed as a place without passion, a place that people grow up and leave. It's wonderful to have met so many great people, compassionate, friendly, warm citizens of your city. As John indicated, I'm from New York, or as we now call it, the Kingdom by the Sea, the next great lake of America. And somehow, some serendipitous happenstance has brought me to this little paradise in the Midwest to escape all of that. And while some of my thoughts and concerns are back in the city, somehow I think we'll pull through and we'll make it. Most New Yorkers are holding their hand out saying, is it raining? Should I get my umbrella? Very steely kind of people. So thank you for having me and for allowing me to put into three dimensions what was essentially two dimensions when I was writing this book. One day, the idea of writing about Ronald Reagan just came to me. You know how sometimes people will say, how did you write that song, or where did you get that idea from? And they say, it just comes to you. And I now know what that is. A moment, it's not there. The next moment, it is there. But because of my background, I always had an interest in the middle layer of Hollywood, not the superstar layer, and not the kind of mundane extra level, the workaday level. I was always interested, like I am in literature and in theater, in the periphery that makes the top layer work. And I could think of nobody better than Ronald Reagan for so many reasons. First of all, the very fact that he wasn't a superstar, but lasted in Hollywood, I guess almost 25, 30 years, says something. It says something about, certainly about endurance, certainly about a stick-to-itiveness, a word I learned writing Erin Brockovich's life story, stick-to-itiveness. As she kept on saying, that was my father's favorite word, stick-to-itiveness. Look it up in the dictionary. Okay, I mean, let me look that word up when I get a chance. The definition of which Ronald Reagan certainly fulfills. And the third aspect that absolutely fascinated me was the notion of character. Having lived and worked in Hollywood, I can tell you that character is harder to find than Thai food. It's a very rare commodity. As a matter of fact, the absence of character will get you very far in show business. When you have it, it becomes something of a burden because you have to consider the right thing, what to do, what's good for the other guy as well as what's good for you. And Ronald Reagan certainly had that. People have often asked me when this book came out, why did you write about the Hollywood years? Most people don't associate Ronald Reagan anymore with Hollywood. They see it as kind of a brief mistake corrected by politics, something that better forgotten about. And you should see Ronald Reagan as somebody who was born, spent his childhood as a governor, and then when he grew up to adulthood, became president. Well, that kind of interested me, that missing gap in Reagan's biographical history. But I could never articulate why I wanted to write about the Hollywood years. And I was telling some people last night, I just got back from Spain. I was in Spain and France. And let me, I'm happy to report to you, they're still there, they're still functioning. And I had an afternoon free, and I decided to go to the Picasso Museum in Barcelona. If you've ever been there, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. It's one of the few museums dedicated to one person, obviously, but you are directed through the museum into a series of pathways, and each one represents another period in Picasso's life. There are only two paintings in this museum that are cubist, that Picasso did, that when you see it, you know, the profile, the front, the top, down, crying, laughing, all of that, triangles. I mean, all the Picasso that we know. But that's the end of the museum's tour. The beginning and the middle have to do with the years that made him Picasso. You know, his father was a painter, and Picasso grew up in an artistic family and spent time in Barcelona and Paris and was part of this expressionist movement of painting. And what that was, when the camera was invented, it changed art. It changed the reason for art. Art had always been the responsibility of capturing realism. It was the only record of what a person looked like before the camera. Once the camera was invented and then film, art took on different meanings. It became less a picture of realism than an expression of what was on the artist's mind. Van Gogh, Starry, Starry Night. It's not a picture about stars. It's a picture about how Van Gogh saw those stars. As I walked through the museum, I realized that to understand cubism and the end of Picasso's career, all that followed, you had to know what the middle was, how that came to be. And that's when I finally realized why I wrote about Ronald Reagan in Hollywood. Because without understanding that middle period, Ronald Reagan appears like an apparition on the political scene. And he's not there, and then he's there. So that's the reason I decided to look at this part of his life, to see how he developed, how non-realism, or the world of Hollywood, created a man of integrity, character, truth, and the ability to communicate. That's what film taught Ronald Reagan. He's a perfect product of what I call the three stages of life. There is making a living, and in making a living, that's where you learn your craft, that's when you go to school, that's when you form your relationships, that's when your parents bring you up, and that's when you start your earning years. That's making a living. The second phase is making a killing. That's when you make your big breakthrough. A good Hollywood phrase too, making a killing. You know, when someone says, I made a killing in the stock market, they don't mean that they killed their stockbroker, which, by the way, not that unusual these days, but it means the opposite. It means that they made a big breakthrough. They bought the right stock. They made a killing. And that happened with Ronald Reagan when he delivered the Rendezvous with Destiny speech. That Sunday night, and I'm old enough to remember it live, it was, I think it was 9 o'clock on a Sunday night, the party had bought the same time placement that the old GE Theater, and I think Death Valley Days, had run, Sunday nights at 9 o'clock, and purchased it for a speech for Ronald Reagan to make in support of Barry Goldwater. You know, Barry Goldwater was nominated almost by a process of elimination. They had to put somebody up to lose because nobody could beat Lyndon Johnson in 1964. I mean, he could turn into the guy he became and still get elected. So they had to have somebody to run. And they decided upon Barry Goldwater. First of all, he was the only one who would run. Nobody wanted to lose. And Barry Goldwater was a very honorable, wonderful guy, man of integrity and big ideas, but he couldn't speak that well. He wasn't a speech maker. And also, he had this unfortunate habit of falling off the stage because of his pre-stage preparation. He used to throw a few back, and then he'd get on stage, and he'd kind of go backwards and never come forwards. So, in sheer desperation, a group got together and said, we have to find somebody who can make a decent speech and keep this election within reason, within reach. And the last scene in the book takes place in Ronald Reagan's kitchen. And all the members, Annenberg and all those who would one day form what became known as the kitchen cabinet, were sitting around a table saying, who can we get? Who can we get to make a speech that will make people sit up and listen? And everybody's head slowly turned. There was Ronald Reagan. And they said, you do it. You're the guy. And this book ends as a kind of a prequel, because you know everything that's going to follow. You know, he makes this speech. He becomes the governor of California 4 years later, I think 4 years later. And then, if my math is right, 12 years later, he becomes president. And it all begins the night he made a killing. How? By being the great communicator. The phrase, rendezvous with destiny, that's a phrase only Ronald Reagan can come up with. It's got the romance of Hollywood, rendezvous, and it's got this notion of destiny. And really, without knowing it, he was talking about himself. He was talking about his own future, which reminds me of what Heraclitus, or Heraclitus, depending upon which college you went to, the great philosopher came up with this amazing perception. And that was that character and fate are not separate. You know how people say, oh, I bemoan my fate, or why did this happen to me, or how come this guy is doing so well and I'm not? And they take fate and they separate it. They put it over here. Fate, you know, George Bernard Shaw's puppets of My Fair Lady, or Pygmalion, manipulating human behavior. And Heraclitus said, no, fate is character. Character is fate. And that, in a single sentence, is how Ronald Reagan became president. It wasn't the rendezvous with destiny speech. It wasn't the tutorial of the governorship. It was his character that led him to be the leader of the free world and to free a lot of the world that wasn't free. So where did this character come from? Well, surely childhood. He was blessed with loving parents. Undoubtedly, his experience right here, same air that we're breathing, where he excelled in everything. I mean, when you read the yearbook, you need to read the sequel to continue all the things that he did. I mean, obviously, someone who loved life and loved living life. Then when he went to Hollywood, actually, as I'm sure you know, as a sportscaster, he kind of walked in backwards to Hollywood. He had dinner with a friend. She said to him in one of those, something that could come out of a movie, take off your glasses. You know, he wore those thick glasses. You know, from this angle, you don't look so bad. Maybe this way a little bit. And she said, you ought to see my agent. So he went to the agent. And the agent happened to know Jack Warner, the head of Warner Brothers. Now, at the time, Hollywood was in a bit of a mess. The films had gotten a little out of hand. There was a lot of violence, a lot of sex, a lot of you name it. Everything that's in Hollywood today actually was going on back then, and only better. They needed, Jack Warner especially, was looking for somebody who he could point to and say, see, Hollywood is a good place. These are good people. They're wholesome guys. You could take them home to your family. When he saw Ronald Reagan, he said, this is a guy that I can use to support the notion of Hollywood as a family business. Years later, when Ronald Reagan was running for governor, somebody asked Jack Warner what he thought about it. And Jack Warner said, Reagan is governor? No. Reagan is governor's best friend? Yes. And that really was the role that Reagan took on for Warner Brothers. I think he made 53 movies, and every movie is essentially the same character. Strong, upright, decisive, and the pal to the hero. No matter what Errol Flynn did in the movies and off screen, somewhere in the film, Reagan would say, are you sure you want to do that? Or do you think that's the best way to handle the situation? I think in Santa Fe Trail, when Errol Flynn is about to kill 500 people with six bullets, Reagan says, wait a minute, maybe there's another way. Maybe we can do this another way. And by doing these films and doing this character over and over and over again, something very interesting happened. Reagan learned to be a pretty good actor because through practice he was able to develop this call upon character, you know, the same guy. But more than that, he learned to be a company man. And that is really the key. Jack Warner used him for 16 years plus five that he took, that Warner Brothers took credit for Reagan's army contributions. And that's three contracts that Jack Warner kept on using him, because he didn't have the problem of selling a film with Ronald Reagan. Reagan was a B movie actor. The B movies were the films that they showed before the feature. You know, in those days, going to the movies was a family affair, hopefully, and you'd come in and you'd see a newsreel, you'd see coming attractions, you'd see a short about the history of Albania, something that, you know, nobody had any interest in seeing. And the newsreel, which was the only way people saw the news in those days, and then a B movie. And a B movie was something as people were streaming in, this movie would be running. And nobody had to pay any special attention to them because they were all the same. They were action films, they were car crash films, they were rescuing the girl on the train tracks. They're always the same. In fact, they used to use the same scripts, change the name of the characters, change the city, change the year, and make them over and over again because nobody watched them. So as long as there was something on the screen, ask people, hey, how are you doing? I haven't seen you in a while. Oh, you too, great, how's the family? These films would be running off. And The star of all the Warner Brothers B movies was Ronald Reagan. So because nobody was looking, he was able to practice this craft of communication. And because these roles were all essentially the same, he learned how to do it. He learned how to communicate a message over and over again and make it seem fresh, new, and revelatory, as if it were just happening. Finally, after the war broke out, World War II, all the actors were gone. They all either volunteered or were drafted into the army. And Reagan's number was coming up. So because there was nobody left, Jack Warner put Reagan into King's Row. I don't know if you've ever seen King's Row. Ever see that film? It's an amazing movie. It's one of the few Hollywood movies, not only made in that time, but made in any time, that deals with social standing as the basis of a cross-lover romance. Ronald Reagan plays a poor boy from the other side, literally from the other side of the train tracks, who falls in love with a well-to-do girl and pays dearly for it because her father doesn't think that he's socially acceptable. And so, in a fit of pique, the father cuts off Reagan's legs. And for the rest of the film, he's in bed. This film struck a nerve in America because of the war, soldiers were coming home, like today, maimed, crippled, bedridden. And so people who went to see this film could identify with the Reagan character. Here's somebody who struggled, who was trying to do the right thing, fell in love with a girl, was living out the American dream, and it was cut short. The powerful, moving moment. Suddenly, Reagan was promoted from B movies to A movies. Jack Warner said, hey, we've got this diamond in our midst, and we've never polished it, we've never seen it. Here's our new star, especially in wartime. So Jack Warner commissioned a script tailor-made for Ronald Reagan and his frequent co-star, Joan Bennett, actress from the 40s, very popular. The Army came knocking at Reagan's door and they said, time for him to go. Jack Warner said, let me keep him for one more movie. And they said, well, what kind of a movie is it? And Jack Warner said, it's a very patriotic film. It'll get a million kids to enlist in the Army. And so he took out the movie that he had planned for Reagan, and he put in something called This Is the Army. You may have seen it, it's on TCM a lot. Written by Irving Berlin. I mean, how much more patriotic can you get? And the whole film is a series of songs. Soldiers happily singing and people dancing. And there's one thread that holds the movie together, and it's the only non-singing role in the film, and that's Ronald Reagan. And he's the guy who you see in the film. Well, maybe, I think so. They're about to go on with their number. And that's his role in the film. The military loved it. And it's a great film. I think it's, if I'm not mistaken, the biggest moneymaker that Warner Brothers ever had with Ronald Reagan in it. But Jack Warner still wanted him for that movie that he had commissioned. And the Army said, you can't have him. We gave him to you one time, but now he's got to serve his country. Ronald Reagan goes home. I think he was married to his first wife, J.W., if I can say that name here. And just like in the movies, he packs a duffel bag. They have a party the night before. The next day, he throws the bag over his shoulder. He walks out. I'll see you, honey. I'm going to go defend the country. And drives off and gets up to San Francisco, which was the official departure point for the Pacific. And he gets a call from the Army saying, unpack your duffel bag, we're going to be using you to make war films for the government, military films, narration films, a lot of everybody in Hollywood did them, Frank Capra, Why We Fight, John Huston. This became the thing that saved Hollywood, were these military films, because there were no actors. They really had no talent left. While Reagan is making these films for Warner Brothers, Jack Warner goes back to the Army and says, look, he's here, he's making these films, can I just use him in this one film? The Army says no. So the only other actor available, somebody you might have heard of, Humphrey Bogart. And the reason Humphrey Bogart was available was because he had served in World War I, and he was too old to be drafted into World War II. So he always looked a little younger, I think, than he actually was. And Joan Bennett didn't want to do the movie without Reagan. She asked Jack Warner to postpone it, but you know, they had so few films on the schedule. So they got Ingrid Bergman, they got Peter Lorre, Claude Rains, and they put together this film that you might have heard of, Casablanca. The film that would have taken Reagan from B movie status after King's Row to A movie status. He would have been what Humphrey Bogart became. Bogart was really not that big a star until Casablanca. That made him that grizzled, you know, I don't stick my neck out for nobody guy. That was Humphrey Bogart. But Reagan never complained. He never said, hey, that should be my movie. He actually felt that he was doing better service making these, in effect, propaganda movies than making Casablanca. Although, you can see in Casablanca some kind of message about neutrality and not being neutral. You know, Hollywood, just as an aside, the morality level was so low in Hollywood then, now, and always will be, that the government said to the studios when we were neutral, prior to World War II, we were officially neutral, but helping England, helping France, helping everybody. You couldn't mention the word Nazi in a movie because it was felt that it would be too provocative to take a political stand. So all these movies leading up to World War II are curiously, they have an enemy who's unnamed, those guys. Those guys who were spying on us in New York, those guys who were blowing up ships, they're never identified as fascists because the government wouldn't let Hollywood take a position. Charlie Chaplin made a film called The Great Dictator in which he spoofs Adolf Hitler and he was called up on contempt charges and would have gone on trial had not Pearl Harbor happened and America was no longer had to be officially neutral. We could suddenly identify the enemy. And Ronald Reagan felt that that was his calling, was to make films, unlike most of the stuff he made, that actually meant something, that people would go to see and better understand why we were fighting, why we were taking on this enemy of mankind. And so through those films, and there you can see them, I think they're available in some kind of release, you can see the birth of Ronald Reagan as something beyond a Hollywood actor, a paid employee of a studio system. And that's where you come to the Rendezvous with Destiny speech. It was the character of Ronald Reagan that the future kitchen cabinet said, this is the guy. And that leads to the third part of making a living, making a killing, and then making a life. And what Ronald Reagan did in Hollywood was making a living and then making a killing. And after that, he was able to make a life. And the life that he made was one of leadership, integrity, courage, and strength. While he was making these films for the government, he had a lot of time on his hands, and he was back in Hollywood, back living exactly where he took off from. He became involved with the Screen Actors Guild. Now, let me just tell you briefly that Hollywood was not a place where unions were welcome. In 1927, when the Writers Guild tried to form the first union, because writers were hired and put into a room with a typewriter and told to turn out scripts, and they would get paid $50 a week or some barely livable wage at that time. And the film, the scripts belonged to the studio. No royalties, no even screen credit. And so they got together and they decided to try to form a union. In Hollywood, in those days, the word union was synonymous with communism, especially to all these Hollywood moguls who had escaped from Europe and come to America and believed in the American dream and wanted to show that dream on screen. That's why during the Depression, everybody's wearing tuxedos and dancing in humongously huge apartments. I mean, their idea was to save the American dream, to sell it through the movies. Reagan became, again, because of character, the head of the Screen Actors Guild. In 1945, when the workers of Hollywood were no longer satisfied with getting Academy Awards in lieu of raises, they decided to have a huge strike. And as you know from the auto industry, you strike one company and it affects all of them. You know, this year we'll strike Ford, this year we'll strike General Motors, and that's the way Hollywood operated. They decided to choose one studio and strike it. The strike was led by a fellow by the name of Herb Sorrell, who was no stranger to unionism in Hollywood. He wanted to form a new union, consolidating all the unions, the Writers Guild, the Screen Actors Guild, all of the guilds into one super union, strike Warner Brothers, and force the studios into capitulating. Herb Sorrell was a big guy, 6'5", 250 pounds, kind of a what you think of as a dock worker, that kind of a tough guy. He came to Ronald Reagan and he said, "I need the Screen Actors Guild support to make my union legitimate. Will you support us?" And Reagan said, "Well, you know, that's a difficult decision to make. I'm a union man. I'm the president of my union. I understand what you're trying to do. I sympathize with what you're trying to do, but I'm also a company man. I work for Jack Warner. Jack Warner is like a father to me," and he was very much so a father figure to Ronald Reagan. So Reagan went to Jack Warner and said, "Here's my problem, here's my dilemma. What do I do?" And Jack Warner, who I think made one too many movies in his life, opened his drawer and pulled out a gun. "Here, take this. Carry it with you at all times." And Reagan kind of looked at him and said, "Good idea." Took the gun, put it in his pocket, walked out of the meeting with Jack Warner, convinced that he needed to stay with this man. That night, or the next day, there was going to be a huge rally in this big arena in Hollywood where they used to hold outdoor fights, fist fights. And Reagan was scheduled to speak. And Herb Sorrell was pressuring him to bring the Screen Actors Guild into this new organization. That night, Reagan got a phone call, an anonymous phone call, and the voice on the other end said, "If you show up at this rally, we're going to kill you." So Ronald Reagan, being Ronald Reagan, put the gun in his pocket like a B-movie, and drove to the rally And on the way over, right up until the end, he was trying to figure out which way to go. The Union, Jack Warner, what's right, what's the right thing to do? And then as he drove in, his car was pelted with tomatoes and all kind of unsavory materials, trying to intimidate him. He got up and he made the most amazing speech, kind of a prelude to Rendezvous with Destiny, supporting the Screen Actors Guild. He had decided that that was the right thing to do. And because he was the president of the guild, he had tremendous sway and influence, and the crowd erupted, standing on their feet, all these Hollywood legends, just everybody cheering for Ronald Reagan. A moment that he had never experienced before. He had never been the star of the show. He had never been the guy who saved the day. He was the guy who saved the day's best friend. So he comes off the podium and he sees Herb Sorrell, the leader of the New Union movement, and Herb Sorrell is holding Gene Kelly by the throat. But Gene Kelly was about 5'11", small, you know, Singing in the Rain, Gene Kelly. And Gene Kelly was a supporter of the Screen Actors Guild. He was a big, with Reagan, a supporter of the Guild. And Herb Sorrell is saying to Gene Kelly, "I'm going to break your neck. I'm going to show you who's boss. You can't go against Herb Sorrell." And Reagan goes over to Sorrell, pulls him around, and grabs him by the neck. And he says to him, "Why don't you pick on somebody your own size?" That became the rallying cry for Ronald Reagan, the president. When Ronald Reagan goes to the Soviet Union or to Reykjavik, his message, in effect, is, "Why don't you pick on somebody your own size? And I'm your size." And that to me, is the great link between Hollywood and Ronald Reagan. I'll stop there. That is the link. His character was built through fantasy, make-believe, fake notions of heroism, and fine-tuned during his years at the Screen Actors Guild. And he took that with him, that character that he became, and he let his fate guide him to bring down the Berlin Wall and to help deconstruct the Soviet Union. So there are people alive today who were born after all that happened, and maybe someday they'll see a Ronald Reagan film on Turner Classic Movies and look at it for a minute and say, "Wow, they made some crazy films in those days," not knowing that there is the genesis of probably the greatest American hero we've ever had. And that's why I wrote the book. Thank you. Thank you. I'll be happy to answer any questions, right? We have time for questions? Okay.
Before questions, I'm gonna ask the first question.
All right.
Which is to say, how many of you would like to see some rare clips of Ronald Reagan films?
Oh, that's right.
Okay. So we're gonna show these sort of a compilation all at once. But before we do, I'm gonna ask Mark if he'll just, in 3 or 4 minutes, just set up the 9 clips that we're about to see.
This was supposed to be the speech, right? The,
yeah. Little grid.
Okay, Love is on the Air. It's Ronald Reagan's first movie. And in it, he plays a crazy combination of a crime fighter and a sportscaster. And you'll see the beginning of what became the Ronald Reagan character. I think this is actually a trailer from the film. Very fascinating, very wonderful to see Reagan at this stage. The next one, Newt Rockne, win one for the Gipper. Reagan was part of what they called the Irish Mafia in Hollywood. There was a round table at Warner Brothers where only the Irish actors could sit, and you had to be invited to be a part of this group. They're headed by Pat O'Brien, who at the time was the biggest star in Hollywood. Jimmy Cagney was at the table, and because Pat O'Brien liked Reagan as a person on the Warner lot, he invited him to join the Irish Mafia, as they called it. And it's because of that that Reagan is in Newt Rockne, in what was supposed to be a small part. But as Reagan discovered through his career, when he was on his back, he was a fantastic actor. Whenever they put him in bed, he just excelled. In Newt Rockne, Win One for the Gipper, which became, you know what it became, and in King's Row, which is the clip that follows, also in bed, legless. And in order to do the part, he struggled with this part. He had no idea how to play somebody who had no legs. He actually had them cut two holes in the bed so he could stick his legs through it and not only appear to have no legs, but feel like he had no legs. Again, on his back. Good job if you can get it. This is The Army, which is a film I told you about, the musical Irving Berlin, Ronald Reagan in a non-speaking role. Bedtime for Bonzo. Here's a film that almost cost him the election. Everybody, all they talked about was Bedtime for Bonzo, Bedtime for Bonzo. How could this guy who played second fiddle to a chimp lead the country? Well, the fact of the matter is that chimp movies were a legitimate genre in Hollywood. Cary Grant did one, Monkey Business, a little film called King Kong that you might have heard of. These films were part of the weird genres that Hollywood had. Tarzan and the chimp, boy, whatever his name was. So when it was Reagan's time to pay his dues and do a chimp movie, he got Bedtime for Bonzo, as his career at this time was slacking off. He never heard the end of it, unfortunately. Clint Eastwood did a couple with an orangutan, Any Which Way But Loose, Any Which Way You Can, whatever those movies are, didn't hurt his career. Then you'll see a clip. We saw these yesterday. The most extraordinary thing I've ever seen in a situation like this. A clip from GE Theater, the TV show that Lou Wasserman gave him after Reagan had fallen so low he was playing Las Vegas. In this clip, you're going to see something extraordinary. You're going to see an unknown James Dean playing a bad guy, pulling a gun on Ronald Reagan, the good guy. And when I saw it, it reminded me of how great our social history is when you see new Hollywood trying to kill off old Hollywood. And you'll see it in this clip. Then Hellcats of the Navy, film he did with Nancy Reagan. Not that good, but by that time it was strictly vehicle stuff. It's a film with Ronald Reagan and Nancy Reagan, who were kind of the Liz Taylor and Richard Burton of their day without the fire. And then you're going to see a clip from the speech. It had the cultural and social impact of Elvis Presley being on Ed Sullivan. It changed culture when the Beatles appeared live. This was a moment, this is what TV was, live. And it changed not only Ronald Reagan's life, but the life of everybody really in the world. This is that moment. This is the killing moment. So, Love is on the Air, Newt Rockne, King's Row, This is the Army, Bedtime for You Know Who, GE Theater with James Dean and Ronald Reagan, Hellcats of the Navy with Nancy Reagan, and The Speech. Here we go.
How do you do, everybody? I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Ronald Reagan. A few months ago, I was a sports announcer on a radio station in Des Moines, Iowa. One day I ran into one of these movie talent scouts. I think I caught him off guard because the next thing I knew, I was taking a screen test for Warner Brothers in Hollywood. I guess it was okay. At least I liked Hollywood, so here I am. They did everything they could to make me feel at home, too. The first picture, well, what do you think it was about? A radio station. Would you like to see a few scenes? Stick around a minute. I got to pull with the operator. Hey, give me an entrance, will you?
And don't bring politics into your program again. As far as murders are concerned, you can leave them to the police department. But I won't sponsor a broadcast devoted to the malicious slandering of our city's leading citizens. That is final. Good night.
If Nichols drops out, we're left with a sustaining program on our hands. There isn't a firm in town with nerve enough to sponsor a spot he puts his finger on.
My job is spreading news. That guy and his mayor brother-in-law are in with Nicey Ferguson's gang. Mr. Nichols is riding for a fall.
And you're the mattress he's going to fall on.
Introducing your news commentator, Andy McCain, and his regular broadcast of hot news with the courtesy of E.E. Nichols Department Store.
Hello again, folks. Here's something hot right off the griddle. George Copeland, who promised to start his war against the city's gambling syndicate today, has been missing from his home since yesterday morning. As yet, there hasn't been a single clue as to his whereabouts.
Well, I can't call you Uncle anymore.
And I can't call you Auntie anymore.
What shall I call you?
What are you doing the rest of your life? Girl in that last scene is June Travis. Nice girl. As I said before, I think I'm going to like Hollywood. She had me in the doghouse for a while in this picture, but I managed to get out of that all right. Then there's Robert Barron, a swell actor, even though we quarreled in the story. Eddie Acuff gets a lot of laughs with his comedy role. Well, that's all I can tell you about the picture, except that when you see it, I hope you like it. If you have a little spare time, why, drop me a line at Warner Brothers Studios in Hollywood. I'll see you in the movies.
George, this telegram just arrived from Walter Camp. You've been named fullback on his All-American team.
Me? You wouldn't kid me, Rock.
No, it's on the level. You're gonna be all right, kid.
I haven't got a complaint in the world, Rock. I'm not afraid. What's tough about this? Rock, someday when the team's up against it, the brakes are beating the boys, ask them to go in there with all they've got, win just one for the Kipper. I don't know where I'll be then, but I'll know about it. I'll be happy.
Andy! Randy! Randy! Where's the rest of me?
Drake.
Randy!
Yes, Drake?
It was that accident.
Yes, dear. But don't talk about it yet.
Paris.
Everything all set for the stage door canteen number, props and everything?
Yeah, I think so. This just came for you.
All right, get on stage, you prima donnas. Let's go. Get on for stage door canteen.
Hey, fellas, get a load of this wire.
Anybody I know, Jan?
We're going on tour. What do you know? Boston, Philadelphia, Washington.
Washington? Hey, wouldn't it be something if the president came to see us, the chief himself?
Yeah, wouldn't it be something if we could get this makeup off our kisses before the war's over? You
Now I know where Bonzo gets his bad habits. You'd better get started on your orange juice. Vacation's over and you've got a lecture at 9.
Yes, ma'am. Oh, Jane, I reloaded the camera. Remember, keep on taking pictures of anything unusual Bonzo does, huh?
Mm-hmm.
What's the matter with him?
Maybe he thinks you're getting more attention than he is.
An Oedipus complex already? I've only been his father for a week.
I think he's just plain hungry. Oh, Bonzo. Eat your pablum like a good boy, and pretty soon you'll grow up to be a big, strong, handsome man just like your daddy. Then you'll have Swedish pancake, too.
That's outright bribery. Bonzo!
Professor Boyd! Bonzo, that wasn't a nice thing to do.
Bonzo!
Don't scold him. He didn't mean it.
Well, that's beside the point. Aggressiveness like that could become an aberration.
Aggressiveness? Aberration? Oedipus complex? What kind of way is that to talk to a baby?
Well, what do you mean?
Why don't you act more like his father instead of like a schoolteacher?
I guess I have got a lot to learn about being father, haven't I?
You sure have, Professor Boyd.
Good evening. I am Ronald Reagan, speaking for General Electric. Tonight from Hollywood, it is my pleasure to appear in a story entitled The Dark, Dark Hours. Young James Dean, one of the bright new actors in Hollywood, appears with me, and Constance Ford plays my wife on the General Electric Theater.
Yes? You the doctor?
Yes.
We had an accident here.
Oh, bring him in. That's a bullet wound. Where'd you get that?
From a gun, man. Where are you going?
To the phone.
Well, it was like we were hunting and like this little bunny.
Yeah, sure, I know.
You don't want to call nobody.
I'm sorry. I have to call the police. That's the law.
Law? We break those all the time, don't we, boy? Oh, I guess we've broken maybe 10 tonight. One more's not going to hurt, Doc.
Look, boys, I don't know what you've done.
Oh, no, 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 Doc. Now, you take out that bullet and stop talking.
I'm not a surgeon.
Well, fake it, Dad.
What?
Look, do the best you can. You dig me?
Commander Abbott.
Case! Case! I was afraid you wouldn't come.
Heard about Wes.
Yes. Dr. Landon. Somehow I feel it's all my fault. Everything's such a mess and I... Let's get out of here. I'll sign out.
I've got a Jeep.
Take over for me, will you, Frankie?
You take over command of the Sea Ray, I'm going to need a new boat and a new exec. Of course, I'm going to need a best man, too. That's a pretty personal thing. That's the way I'd like to face.
Ladies and gentlemen, we take pride in presenting a thoughtful address by Ronald Reagan, Mr. Reagan.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you and good evening. The sponsor has been identified, but unlike most television programs, the performer hasn't been provided with a script. As a matter of fact, I have been permitted to choose my own words and discuss my own ideas regarding the choice that we face in the next few weeks. I have spent most of my life as a Democrat. I recently have seen fit to follow another course. I believe that the issues confronting us cross party lines. If we lose freedom here, there's no place to escape to. This is the last stand on earth. And this idea that government is beholden to the people, that it has no other source of power except the sovereign people, is still the newest and the most unique idea in all the long history of man's relation to man. This is the issue of this election. Whether we believe in our capacity for self-government or whether we abandon the American Revolution and confess that a little intellectual elite in a far distant capital can plan our lives for us better than we can plan them ourselves. You and I are told increasingly we have to choose between a left or right. Well, I'd like to suggest there is no such thing as a left or right. There's only an up or down. Man's old age dream, the ultimate in individual freedom consistent with law and order, or down to the ant heap of totalitarianism. And regardless of their sincerity, their humanitarian motives, those who would trade our freedom for security have embarked on this downward course. You and I have a rendezvous with destiny. We'll preserve for our children this, the last best hope of man on earth, or we'll sentence them to take the last step into 1,000 years of darkness.
so fascinating. I actually like it better seeing them one after the other, because you can see the progress of Ronald Reagan becoming that character in the last clip, in the speech. You can see the rehearsals. You can see 25 years of rehearsing for that moment. A little bit of color, a little bit of drama in this speech, but understanding not only that the message was the right message, but how to make you believe it was the right message. And that is the genius of Ronald Reagan. It's been a great honor to be here tonight. I've written a few books, and sometimes it's like a bad marriage. You know, you're kind of stuck with the subject for a couple of years until the publisher will grant you a divorce. This book was an absolute joy to write because it was a chance to revisit the American dream. In the generation before mine that set it up to make it possible for me to write books like The Great American Dream. Any questions? Happy to answer anything you want to ask me, including what time does the plane leave. Anything. Yes, miss.
Did you ever get the opportunity to personally meet Ronald Reagan?
That's a great question. Almost. When I was living in Hollywood, Reagan had an office in Century City, which is this little kind of artificial village built on the back lot of what was 20th Century Fox, hence Century City. And I was talking to somebody today who actually went up to meet him. What you could do is you could call the office, make an appointment, and go up and meet Ronald Reagan. And I did that. Unfortunately, the day I was scheduled to go, he didn't make it in. So I came this close to my rendezvous with Reagan. But like so many people that I've come to write about and know, the preparation begins so much earlier. There's a new film coming out about Abraham Lincoln, a Steven Spielberg film. I don't think Spielberg ever met Lincoln, although I'm not sure. But you don't necessarily have to personally know a subject of a biography to be able to write one. My book sets you up for all the other biographies that you know, the politicians' books, the history books. Mine is mine's like a B movie. It's in the middle as you're coming in. So, this is a pretty interesting story. And a lot more in the book. It's a pretty colorful account of life in those days. I'm really happy to be able to share a few stories with you tonight. Anybody else? Yes. How many films did he make? I think 53, right? And another 10 years spent making what amount to shorts for TV, 22-minute filmlets for GE Theater. You know, GE Theater was an interesting show for him because he got to play the narrator who explains what these films, these little TV shows, are about. And sometimes he was in them. So he had this double role, and they were very authoritative, because explaining what the film is, it's almost like a sermon, where here's the chapter, and here's what it means. So in Ronald Reagan's case, he did something very unique. He went from playing God on GE Theater to being God, to becoming president. And the progression, very, very clear. That clip from GE Theater, magnificent, I think. Yes, sir?
What helped him get the job with GE? How did that happen?
Let me tell you very briefly. After he left Warner Brothers, his career sunk so low that he and Nancy, I think after the Hellcats, were hired to do a nightclub act in Las Vegas. And Lou Wasserman, the head of Universal, kind of pushed him to do it. Reagan was having some financial problems. He wasn't getting work. And at the same time, there was yet another strike being threatened over royalties in Hollywood. Lou Wasserman came to Reagan and said, figure it out. Don't let this strike happen. Reagan came up with the idea of royalties, that films made after 1948 the actors would get a royalty from the Screen Actors Guild. Pre-1948, they would just get the money that they were paid for one time. Well, I think it was 1951 or 1952, all films were pre-1948, except the last 3 years. So a lot of actors were furious. Mickey Rooney said, Ronald Reagan just took away my pension. But the wisdom of Reagan was that today, all films are post-1948. So he had a vision of how to protect and preserve the Screen Actors Guild and to make it okay to be an actor, to make a living. In payback for coming to that solution, Wasserman was able to get GE to hire Reagan to host this new show. In those days, television programs were owned by the sponsor, not the network. So, you know, Lucky Strike Hour, Chrysler Presents, GE owned that 30 minutes. And they needed an actor to narrate and occasionally be in these no-budget films. So they hit upon Ronald Reagan. And again, his character and his fate melded. That was the beginning of his resurrection. And that's why the Time for Choosing, or Rendezvous with Destiny, looks like an episode of GE Theater, like a narration of GE Theater. And that's how he got it, from Lou Wasserman at Universal, by doing the right thing. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Could you speak to Reagan, and you mentioned Jane W. And, she made a decision not to continue the marriage, is my understanding. And she was involved with Lou Ayres.
That's right.
The movie Johnny Belinda. And I always thought she was classy, though, in that she never said anything about him negative, to my knowledge.
Well, you're right. She was a classy woman in her way, maybe having an affair while she was married. Not the most desirable quality to have in a wife, but Ronald Reagan used to wake up in the morning and have all the newspapers at the kitchen table. And as he was having breakfast, he would say to Jane Wyman, listen to this. Congress says, and she just wasn't that woman. She wasn't the woman that he wanted her to be. So really her escape to Lou Ayres was into a relationship where it wasn't the kitchen table as opposed to the kitchen cabinet. The other aspect to their relationship, much more interesting, I think, was that his career was not going anywhere because of the military and the war, and then afterwards, the whole generation of actors who had been big stars before the war were warehoused for a new crop, the James Deans to come and all that. Her star began to rise. So if you remember the film, A Star is Born, that was a little bit of the complexity of their relationship. In Hollywood, the worst thing that can happen is a wife or a husband will have their career moment at a different time than the spouse. And so to Jane Wyman, her star was rising. Her interest was the future. To Reagan, his star was falling, and that made him even more unattractive to her. It was Nancy who fit that role beautifully. You know, read me another 5 sections of the New York Times. I want to hear every single bit of it. And you explain it so well. She was the right actress to play the role. One more. Or am I, yes. Not so much finding new insights as, this will sound a little strange, I think, revisiting an old friend. I spent a couple of years living with Ronald Reagan, which didn't make my girlfriend very happy, getting to try to get under the skin, try to read between the lines, try to make sense of the progress of his life. And it wasn't the most difficult thing to do because it was all there. It had just never really been looked at, I believe, the way I tried to look at it. Now, coming here reawakens that period of my life when I was saturated with Ronald Reagan and completely out of step with everybody else around me. Well, why do you want to write about Ronald Reagan? Which is precisely why I wanted to write about him, for those kind of comments. That only convinced me even more that I was onto the right track. But coming here today, or yesterday, and being doused, put into the deep water of the Reagan River, it feels like, you know, you spend a long winter trying to keep warm, and then suddenly it's a warm day and you go back in the water and it feels so good. I remember what this is like. That's what this trip has been. It's been a kind of a revisitation to not only a period in Reagan's life, but a period in my own life that I shared with a subject on a very deep, intense, and for me, meaningful period of time. So it's been great. I really love it. I will stay here permanently if New York has disappeared beneath the sea. And then we'll see how happy you are to see me. That's it?
John? So there you have it, Marc Eliot's moving here to Eureka.
Everybody then will be moving to New York.
Marc, thank you on behalf of all of us. I want to mention several people who've been particularly helpful in your visit and excited to have you here, including our two faculty members of the theater department here, Holly Roki. Holly, there you are. Holly is just one of our great faculty members, and Marty Lynch, who I think was upstairs helping on the lights. But to those two, to Tony Glass, our librarian and archivist, I want to acknowledge Tony for a special reason. Although Wayne Whalen is unable to be with us tonight, Wayne is a Chicago attorney who owns the birthplace of Ronald Reagan in Tampa Hill. And part of what Wayne did in purchasing the birthplace was to help save it and preserve it so that thousands of visitors could go through and see the place where Ronald Reagan came into this world, on the second floor, February 6th, a snowstorm. Part of what he acquired when he bought Tampico was every single movie poster that had ever been printed for Ronald Reagan films. So what you see around us is a loan from Wayne Whalen of the original movie posters, and if you would, please take a few minutes to take a look at them. It is the most complete collection. We only have a portion of it here, but the most complete collection that we know of in America. And we're so honored that because of Marc Eliot's visit and because of his books, Wayne Whalen has lent them to us. Tony Glass and his staff has prepared them beautifully, hasn't he? It's just really fun. And finally, I want to recommend, I want to commend somebody who doesn't always get the spotlight, but who's worked extraordinarily hard in preparing the clips that Marc introduced. His name is James Perry. Jim Perry does AV for the college, and we really appreciate it. We appreciate you coming tonight, and to conclude this evening, those of you who would like to purchase books and get an autograph by the author, you are welcome to do so. We'll set Marc right up here. And thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
God bless you all. Thanks.